Economics now covers everything we do in the ordinary business of living. It analyzes what we do by making just a couple of core assumptions about how we actually behave.
It's not bad. I mean,
yeah?
I like it better than I thought I was gonna.
Great. Awesome.
The first assumption is that we're all self-interested.
I don't know, $1,000.
Oh, no way. Wait a minute. No, this car is way better than $1,000.
I'm just throwing out a figure. I don't...
Okay,
you know,
no, that's fine, that's fine. I just...
The second assumption is that we're all rational.
$2,000. I mean, that's...
That is, by weighing the costs and benefits of any action, we can figure out how to maximize our self-interest. That's why economics calls people rational maximizers.
This is a 93 Accord.
Yeah, but it only has like 50,000 miles on it.
Really?
Yeah.
So, for example, when economic woman here sells her car to economic man, he's trying to get the best price he can.
Oh, it's getting a deal here.
You are. You are. You're my bud. Come on. It's a good car. I wouldn't sell you a bad car.
And economic woman is acting in her rational self-interest as well. There must be people who need a car more than this guy, but they can't meet her price.
No.
47. 48.
I can't.
5,000.
5,000.
5,000.
Just bought yourself a car.
Yes!
Now, most of us don't think there's anything wrong with selling at the highest price or buying at the lowest price. That's just human nature, isn't it? To get the most one can using simple reasoning. In fact, rational maximizing turns out to have been the driving force behind market economics from the very beginning. Adam Smith, the first name in economics. Here's how he famously put it in his book, The Wealth of Nations, published the same year as the Declaration of Independence.
Give me that which I want, and you shall have this which you want. It is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, or the baker that we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own interest.
So people are self-interested.
Hey, you just bought yourself a car.
Oh, yes!
And they're supposedly rational.
Can I have the number 9, please?
But how true are these assumptions? Very true, say mainstream economists. To prove the point, textbook author Stan Brew asks students in his class which line they choose at a fast food restaurant.
They say the shortest line. Why? Well, my time is valuable. You know, I don't want to waste my time standing in line. Why don't you get in the longest line? Well, they intuitively understand that. I said, you made some little kind of a cost-benefit decision in your self-interest. It was rational for you to get into the shortest line.
So here, getting in the line with only 3 people would be the rational choice.
Thank you.
But Professor Brew insists that you're even being a rational maximizer if getting on this line turns out to be a whopper of a mistake.
3 cheeseburgers.
Maybe you're in the shortest line and you find out that the person in front of you is ordering fries and hamburgers for the Greyhound bus out back.
4 of the combos.
But you didn't have that information when you got into line.
BLT and cheese, like 10 of them.
Should you now go seek that information by going up to everybody and say, sir, I'd like to get your order so that I can make a rational decision?
Hi, can I get your order so I can make a rational decision?
What?
Heck no. Because the information's costly to get, people would probably wonder what you were up to, and it isn't worth your while. But that's another rational decision.
And yet we can all think of behavior that seems both irrational and counter to what we would usually think of as our own self-interest.
Literally, it's hurting right there in my elbow just to hold it.
Like trying out a shot put for the first time in one's late 50s.
Yeah, but then you gotta throw it.
I decided not to make an irrational fool of myself, but instead asked students at this track meet if they'd encountered much irrationality in their lives lately.
Well, being in college, I mean, I've seen a lot of irrational things, so I'd probably say the most irrational thing that I've seen is a guy getting naked at a party.
Yeah, I can top it. One of my friends, unfortunately, we were at a party together, and... we went to the party together, so we're kind of keeping an eye on each other, and he got out of sight, and one thing led to another. He was going to the 7-Eleven to get some cigarettes. He borrowed someone's truck. He had no idea whose truck it was, and he ended up about 30 miles away from Lowell in the woods. He had crashed drunk driving, and That was pretty irrational, I'd say.
Sleeping in class always happens.
Sleeping in class?
Yes. It's normal to stay up till 4 and then go to class and sleep.
But that isn't rational.
No, it doesn't make sense.
Well, how much are you paying for a class? I mean, for example.
I know we pay about $115 a class.
$115 a class?
Yeah.
And you sleep through some of them?
Sometimes.
So that would be irrational.
Yeah, my dad knew he would probably kill me.
And there's getting into shape today only to overeat for the next 2 weeks, being scared to compete on Friday the 13th. The list is endless. In economics, even tipping at a roadside restaurant can seem irrational.
Do you leave tips at roadside restaurants you're never going back to?
Yeah, I definitely do. I've waitressed before, so I leave tips.
You do?
Absolutely. Absolutely leave tips.
But why? You're never going to go back there.
Because if she's done a good job, she should be rewarded for it.
I work at a restaurant where we have a collection of tips that are split at the end of the night, and I know that it feels like not to be tipped because I'd say 50% of the people that come in there don't, so I would definitely leave a tip.
Indeed, the model of a purely self-interested homo economicus, economic man, is so simplistic, it's long been the subject of satire.
How do you do? I'm a merchant banker.
Oh, how do you do, Mr.?
I forget my name for the moment, but I am a merchant banker.
As when an investment or merchant banker is solicited by a charity worker.
I wondered whether you'd like to contribute to the orphan's home.
I don't understand. Can you just explain exactly what you want?
Well, I want you to give me £1, and then I'll go away and give it to the orphans.
Yes?
Well, that's it.
No, I don't follow this at all. I mean, I don't want to seem stupid, but it looks to me as though I'm £1 down on the whole deal.
Oh, yes, you are.
I am. Well, what is my incentive to give you £1?
Well, the incentive is to make the orphans happy.
Happy? You're quite sure you've got this right.
Yes, lots of people give me money.
What, just like that?
Yes.
Must be sick.
But this banker from the English TV comedy series Monty Python's Flying Circus isn't a fair example of the rational maximizer, according to some economists.
Nice to do business with you!
They argue instead that acts of apparent altruism, such as giving money to orphans, tipping, or as here at MIT, free bike repair, really do maximize self-interest by making the person who does them feel better.
You know, Mother Teresa, you know, was not selfish. No one would say she was selfish, but she pursued her self-interest. She did the things that made her happy, and that was to help other people, and avoided the things that brought her pain, watching them suffer. And we all do that to some extent. We leave tips at roadside restaurants we'll never see again. Why? Because it'll make us feel bad if we don't. And so acts of altruism are acts in self-interest. They're unselfish, but they're self-interested.
But to critics of economics, and more economists, this is too broad a definition of self-interest. If anything you do is self-interested, because it must make you feel better or you wouldn't do it, the idea of rational maximizing loses its power to explain. If this poor guy, say, starts drinking his oil instead of spraying it and drops dead, we don't explain anything by saying that he must like oil, and so drinking it had to be an act of rational self-interest. In fact, the 2002 Nobel Prize for Economics went to a psychologist and an economic experimenter for showing just how human humans can be. Bob Frank, who came up with the oil example, is a star of behavioral economics, a new field that he says
unites psychology and economics. I think the neoclassical economists were guilty for a long time of ignoring human psychology, and what the behavioral economics movement has done is bring some of the known facts about human psychology back into the picture. We're not always the rational automatons assumed by the neoclassical model, and I think that's been one of the interesting contributions of behavioral economics, is to remind economists that we're really kind of a richer, more complicated creature than some of the models suggest.
Bottom line, then, there's a debate within economics about how accurate the basic economic assumptions, rationality and self-interest, really are, and thus about the basic economic model of human behavior. Professor Nancy Fulbray is another noted critic of the neoclassical model.
I think it's half right. I think in a lot of situations people make very rational decisions with a lot of foresight and a lot of information. I think in general, economists still overstate the extent to which you can explain everything with a rational utility maximizing model.
On the other hand, says Stan Brew, that model is true enough in the end to make some pretty useful predictions about economic behavior.
Well, I'm going to predict that people will prefer a higher wage to a lower wage, other things equal. And I'm going to predict that a consumer will prefer a lower price to a higher price, other things equal, like the quality of the product. And I'm going to predict that a business is going to try to earn more profit rather than less in terms of rational decision processes under normal, usual circumstances. But people aren't perfect decision makers, and just because they don't always behave in some perfect rational way doesn't mean that it isn't valuable to have an assumption that they act as if most of the time.
But the assumption economics makes is that people act as if they were rational maximizers all of the time. And bottom line, that's the assumption that just about every textbook and every textbook model is based on.
10 Diet Cokes, 12 Cokes.